Welcome to the Detroit Public Library's virtual event. Circle Poetry Collective presents Cypher. I'm Tanika Chapman Mills, Department Manager at Maine Library, and I'm also joined by my colleague, Dawn Taylor, who's joining us and working behind the scenes this evening. Circle is a diverse group of women at various stages in their writing lives, connected through an intimate love of language. Lady Miss Adrian founded Circle in 2020 at Room Project in Detroit. Circle meets online weekly to read, write, and talk about poetry centered on BIPOC writers. The readings, exchange of ideas, and time to write and share their work has developed into a tightly bonded sisterhood of poets. Cypher is the result of this shared experience. Members hail from Metro Detroit, Flint, Ann Arbor, and as far away as France. How cool is that? Circle members appearing this evening are Emily Francis, Sonia Van Deloach, Lady Miss Adrian, Lujane Nasrella, Tasha Cole James, Yuling Lawrence, Mariko Brenner, and Marywin Curtin. Welcome, Circle.
Hi, I'm Adrian. I'd like to introduce Emily Francis. Emily is a poet and educator born in Ann Arbor and raised in Toledo. She currently lives in Metro Detroit with her husband, two kids, and three cats. She's the co-host of the podcast, Then She Did, A Quest for More. And she is a student at Randolph College MFA program.
Thanks, Adrian. Hi, everybody. So excited to be here. I'm going to just read my two poems in our Cypher collection. The first poem is called Another Mound of Dirt. Another mound of dirt erupts. A mystery, the fourth this week. No hole, no tracks or tongue of shovel. A mole, the neighbor said. Tunnels lace our yards. The ground ready to collapse into the highway below, the same way you sometimes stumble into hope, falling through belief onto another road of survival. The neighbor's dog catches the moles even underground and plucks birds out of the sky quick and ruthless, to say nothing of the coyotes or mottled roots of the woods that force them into the open field of our yard, to say nothing of us. Still the most dangerous animal in the world. How can they expect to survive? Maybe hope is simply surfacing again, another mound of dirt on the crisp morning snow. And my second poem is called How to Love an Exoskeleton. When you don't touch me, my body forgets. What bodies would do with another one. Insides so soft, neither of us may survive. To unearth feeling from the shell, best to announce yourself. I'm going to touch you now and pause. My skin squirms, but that doesn't mean danger. It means I'm alive. It means my body hears and will be with you shortly. It means I don't know how to say how far I am or how impossible it feels to find my way, my body like a slow memory of unfolding. Thank you. It is now my, thank you, Sonia. It's now my pleasure to introduce the lovely Sonia. Where did you go on here? Oh, are we going, Sonia's next, right? Sorry. Okay, Sonia Van Deloach. Sonia, whose family is her muse, has written for the New York Times, Chicago Tribune, and Detroit Free Press, where she was a copy editor. She took up poetry in spring 2020 in the Circle Writing Group, where she wrote a poem that appears in Chicken Soup for the Soul, I'm speaking now, Black Women Share Their Truth, and 101 Stories of Love, Courage, and Hope. Sonia lives with her husband in Ann Arbor.
Thank you, Emily. I too am going to read from Cypher my two poems. One is called Sonia's Eye. And I don't know if you can see that it is an eye, but it also talks about the eye with which I see. Sonia's Eye. At middle age, I am still and happily becoming myself. My family, of birth and of choice, buoys me in my quest. But on this journey, I must go solo into the salt mines. Horizontal movement, vertical thinking, diagonal action. I salute ancestors along the way forward. I'm the last in my line, but I shall be the first going up. Artie May, Mervyn McKinley, Ola May, Leo, Lucille, Nancy Lucille, Michelle Renee, Tiffany, Stephen Elijah, Stoney, Jacqueline, Elsie, Fred, Armstead, Russell Cecil. Thank you. And my next poem is called Duplex Ed, after Jericho Brown. My neighbor Ed is raking in a windstorm. Orange leaves eddy around his feet. Orange leaves eddy around his feet. On a ladder, Ed blows leaves from his gutter. On a ladder, Ed power washes our house. At 80, he's handier than my husband, who played guitar as Ed tilled my garden. Ed is a spot of red on a block of blue. I'm a spot of black on a block of white. I miss being in the majority. Ed's candidate lost the majority's vote. Still 70 million fight a dying cause. Ed lost his brother and the election. My neighbor is raking in a windstorm. Thank you. That particular poem, I was afraid at first to read it or to let Ed see it. Ed is my next door neighbor, obviously. And he really liked it, and we've become really close friends since then. I babysit his cat. He takes me to the airport, picks me up. So yeah, can have political differences and still be friends. Thank you. Let's see. And I would like to introduce Lady Miss Adrian. Lady Miss Adrian was born and raised in Flint. She earned a BFA in creative writing from the Residential College at the University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, where she studied under Ken Michalowski. She's been published in Hearty Greetings and Queen of Cups, and was a featured reader at Paris Lit Up. She founded the writing group Circle in 2020. Lady Miss Adrian is never without pink sparkly lip gloss and wishes she were in Paris right now, drinking coffee, reading, writing, and synchronized swimming. Welcome.
Thank you, Sonia. I'm going to read two poems, one from Cypher and one newer poem. This is Maps. I've grown accustomed to you sleeping on the very edge of the bed, ready to stick your toe out into the summer heat. We didn't grow up with air, only our father's selfishness and their box fans facing out, not in. When I scooch my body close against yours, you let your arm fall asleep from the weight of my head. Sometimes I let go of you and curl up on my other side because my hip hurts. Sometimes I let go of you to see if you'll turn to find me. You need to sit facing every door. You face me, but you also face every door, prepared for a crisis. My shoulders collapse inward when I sit. For my sake, you pretend not to notice. I stared at a map of the world on our menu, which caused me to wonder when the continents broke apart. Now I know. They are eternally crashing into each other and breaking apart again. New lands, new oceans. And this is a newer poem. It's called Dear Sifjan. Dear Sifjan, you remember the second Age of Odds show at the Prospect Park Bandshell on August 3rd? Who could forget a four-hour downpour? Outdoors, uncovered, you covered your clothes, your face with neon tape turned glow in the dark, in the dark. Your dancers all slick and slinky, all hula hoops, moving graphic backdrops, stage lights swinging from wing to wing. The downpour, a torrential drench of rain and synthesizers mesmerizing the chorus of us. Our rain-soaked arms in the air, your rib cage caged, braced to hold your wings of implausible breath. Your auto-tune, your voice held notes we held. We packed tightly, wetly, our clothes stuck close to our skin, our shoes sacrificed. Our arms in the air, each of us reaching to keep bouncing balls in the air, each of us filled with breath, with chorus. Remember the encore, you covered yourself in balloons and balloons and balloons and tinsel and a pair of silver plastic shutter shades. Imagine the odds. You took them off and hurled them into the mass of us. They landed in my hands like a slippery silver miracle. In my hands, in the downpour of rain, of sound, of color, of bodies, of light, of chance, a deluge of blessings baptismal. Thank you. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Lujain. Lujain Nasrallah spends most of her time reading, eating, or doing something outside. She wanted to be a paleontologist when she grew up, but chose to work as a communication specialist at the Arab American National Museum and Access, a community nonprofit. Born and raised in East Dearborn, she currently lives in Detroit.
Thanks, Adrian, and thanks everyone for tuning in tonight. I'll be reading both poems from Cypher today. And the first one is called, Our Calls Last No More Than 10 Minutes. Did you pray today? She asks me every time I call. I don't want to lie. I don't lie. Ya Habibti, our time is short. Find the path again before you lose yourself completely. You used to love to pray. A friend once told me that her father lied to his mother so she would stop praying for him. But I don't want mama to stop praying for me. At least then we'll have something to talk about. I ask what she made for dinner. She tells me to come over and eat with her. I've been protesting for 100 days, mama. It's not safe to come over. Allah will take care of it. Like he took care of you. I want to say it, but I don't. I wonder what she wants to say to me, but doesn't. And the next poem is called King of Swords. And I'll clarify that this is about my grandfather, because in a very hilarious turn of events, a friend thought I was writing this as a love poem. And I was like, I mean, in so many ways that I love my grandfather, but not a romantic way. King of Swords. Science debunks the fact that humans lose most of their body heat through their head. Still, Jidda wore his black knit hat year round. The smell of cigarettes lingered in the thread. To protect the crown, he said. He would come over in the winter with 2 pomegranates, pull a paring knife from his pocket, cut around the crown of the fruit before tearing the rind apart with his hands. Gently coaxing the seeds from the pith, I would watch, waiting. He would drop them in a bowl for me as he chewed on the bitter white flesh, picking the sticky parts from his teeth with the knife. This is how I remember him. Warm as a chimney, danger between his smile, bitterness on his tongue, hands that will perform the truest act of love. Thank you, everyone. And now I have the honor of introducing our next reader, Tasha, because Mitzi is not here today. Tasha Cole James has been a lover of the arts her entire life. She expressed this love through performing in plays while in college and local theater a few years after. As life would have it, she settled in as a social worker, but the love of the arts, writing, and performing remains full in her heart. She is grateful for her first opportunity to have her poems published with an awesome group of seasoned and amazing poets. It's all yours, Tasha.
Thank you, Lou Jane. Thank you everyone for being here this evening. I'll be reading two poems, one poem from our book, Cypher, and one new poem. The first poem is called They Just Show Up. Hiding. Folding in on top of myself, edited into the alien's form in order to survive, to thrive, code switch, learn a new language to make sure they get the order right, dress in black, navy blue, white shirt, resume filled with bachelor's, master's, some PhDs, might hold weight and teleport me to the American dream, like a spaceship. It's just the aliens don't have to audition. They just show up. And my second poem is Full Immersion. I accept she no longer wants me. Born, no assembly required. I thought I was having a baby, but gave birth to a lightning bolt. Orisha trickster, Eshu, stirring my world, pushing chess pieces askew, including my life. Ready-made, fearless frontal, risky adventurer, a beautiful antithesis to the mother who cowers and hides, making oneself invisible. You do not succumb to this. Making your needs known, you teach me a tradition in reverse. You say, why do you hide? What are you afraid of? I always think, what if it goes right? Thank you. Our next poet hails from the village of Jouy, France. Yungling Lawrence was born in Hong Kong. She graduated from CUHK with a BA and from Essex, France with an MS in management. She is now a Chinese brush painting artist and explores her love of nature also through other forms of art, notably poetry, pottery, music, and photography. Welcome, Yungling Lawrence.
Yeah. I'm very pleased to be here to read my two poems, which you can find in Cypher. The first poem is called My Favorite Things. Oh, Pontresina, the hills are alive with the sound of music. He and I were young and energetic, singing along the path towards the peak. We had come to know each other the day before this hike. Oh, Pontresina, backpacks on our back and let's go Europe in our hands. The next day we took the Bernina Pass to Tirano, where we stopped and waited for the return train. Oh, Tirano, we had so much to say by the fountain. We missed our train, and took the next train. There was yet no pain. Oh, St. Morris, we're coming to see your beautiful lake. On the train, he handed me the paper on which I could read, Gift of David Gates. If a man could be two places, at one time I'd be with you. I kept my mouth shut, but my eyes wide open like your lake. Oh, St. Morris, I had not expected to see you. I had to say adieu to you and you and you and you. A few months later, he wrote me a postcard ending with, when a dog bites, when a bee stings. Oh, St. Morris, you knew when we were feeling sad. Oh, Pontresina, but you heard us singing merrily, my favorite things. The second one is called Christmas Day 2020. Life walks through me, up and down, like Chopin's movements. I walk through life down and up, like Bach's rhythm. Open my heart is what I learn, my way, hallelujah. I'm in Japan, it is where I'm not. I was in Singapore, it was where I was not. I was in Germany, it was where I was not. I was in France. It was where I was not. I was in Hong Kong. It was where I was not. Then where should I be, have been? Here and now, I revisit, re-explore, and rediscover myself and my culture. In English, 用中文, en français, Sultan of Deutsch, 日本語でダメ. The only thing I know I am is a colorful dish of chop suey. My other half is still asleep. Echoes are streaming in the wall.
Je n'aurais jamais cru qu'une petite femme puisse prendre autant de place dans mon cœur.
I was in his heart, and he was mine. Then come invading other echoes. The canons of Tchaikovsky's 1812 overture. I now know what I own is what I do not own. I'm here. I'm here and not here. Beginning is not a beginning. For beginning is the end of another end. You may wonder what I'm doing now. I'm listening to John Lennon's Happy Christmas. War is over. Maybe you did not understand what the man said, yeah, in the second poem, the first soundtrack. Yeah, that was in French, and it means, I would have never believed that a small woman could take up so much space in my heart. Now I have the honor to introduce you the next poet, Mariko Brenner. Mariko Brenner enjoys multiple lives. Fiber artist, muse, healer, drama resolution guide, and hypnotist. You can often find Mariko caring for her plants in her garden, or dreaming of building her own home with enough land for 6 happy sheep. Her poems and essays have been collected in Cypher Volume 1, Inspired Poach Magazine, and the multi-authored book, Success Cooks, Secrets to Success We Weren't Taught in School. Mariko is currently working on her first full-length book. Mariko?
Hello. I'm going to read 2 poems tonight. One is from Cypher and one is a new poem. So this one has no title yet, but it was written in 3 different columns, and my intention was to actually write this poem from the perspective of my partner and myself, and then we're meeting in the middle. Holding my lover in my arms, her sleepy head rests on my shoulder. Excited for the unknown voyage, I could write a poem to this pregnant moment. Tea on the stove as I prepare for a long 9 days at sea with many battles yet to come. Awake at daybreak, silent fish swim in my notebook. We make out the outlines of our typography with our eyes. A smile once was here. I wait for your next text like some oblique message in a bottle. As I float in a sea of lazy uncertainty, spending the morning coffee in hand, working steadily on some banal piece of writing. The steady hum of the computer reminds me of a voluntary straitjacket I put on. While beyond my window, the green grass reminds me of how fleeting summer is. Soon it will be winter. And then the second one is from Cypher, and it's called Things My Mother Said to Me. Things my mother said to me. Don't talk about money. It's rude to ask how much things cost. Don't wear white, ever. Don't be lazy. The only shame is not to wear your clothes. Clean up, but don't take up too much space. When invited to dinner, help your host. Do the dishes for her party. Don't spend all your money in one place, ha ha ha. The note tucked inside my lunch box at summer camp reads, next to the Oreos juice box, lunch meat sandwich. This is how I learn about humor. The year I am living outside Philly, I invite the stray boyfriend home for Thanksgiving. He is quick to point out how my mother and I walk in the same way, both laughing as we shuffle our cold feet in the snow. Thank you. And it's my pleasure to introduce Mary Wynne Curtin. Mary Wynne Curtin is an artist and writer living in Detroit. She explores cities extensively by bicycle and on very long walks, then documents the experience in artists' books or abstractly as industrial embroidery, assembled from ephemera found along the way. An author and editor primarily of educational publishing, she is happiest writing about Detroit in art and artists for the publications Essayed and The New Examiner.
Thank you. And thank you all for being here tonight. I'm going to read two poems, both of them from Cypher. And this is Cracking Open. Sometimes my phone won't accept my touch. Passcode numbers won't glow beneath my fingertips, and I wonder if I'm a ghost. Or maybe it's just that my hands are too cold to register, so I rub them together like I'm about to crack open a safe, trying to break into my life. The jaws of life are built to break you out of a metal cage that once was speed and freedom. The jaws of life might chew you to a pulp, and from pulp comes paper, and from paper comes a blankness. Pure possibility that attracts poems and plans and diagrams of other worlds, like all that exists is drawn to fire and light. And I saw the light because there is nothing left, nothing left. Just an empty cave of truth lived yet never seen. Dopamine deprivation, maybe. A daily darkness suddenly stark. I loved the cave I didn't know was all shadows. But I love the smashed stone more. I'll take some time to stretch out on the rubble and watch the dust play in the streams of light. Thank you. And the last poem of the night is called Suture. Power emanates from my grandmother's sewing box, a trove of tools for mending and hints of how. Mercerized colors wrapped around wooden spools, an array of ways to make the worn out whole again. Holy relics of a life I never witnessed now is mine in many forms. I have the needle in hand and the blessing of hindsight, a sight line of the ancestral lineage, a way to see the weight and the burden and the tears in the souls that were stuffed into a bag, untended, unmended, when the pain was too much to believe that restoration was possible. But now I pin it all together. I gather the thread of the family line to stitch up the wounds of my own life and my mother's and her mother's. I slide the needle through this time and back. I take up the mantle and say, it will end with me. I will echo back, healing. Thank you.
If anyone has any questions, feel free to enter them in the chat or use the Q&A box. Your work is really heartwarming, and it was things that I could relate to. Anybody just jump in, tell us what's your inspiration, what's your process?
Well, for me, I wanted to have people remember my ancestors. Some of them have been long gone, and some of them more recent, and some of them were elders when they departed, and some were quite young, from say a car accident and an asthma attack. So yeah, I think it's important for the family that goes on to know who came before. And I think we should all call the names of our ancestors who've gone on. I know people have lost a lot of people recently. So that was my inspiration for one.
I see that love was a theme for another one, and it helped open our minds that it's more than romantic love. Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
Sure, I can talk about that. It was like a funny anecdote that my friend later was like, "Ooh, I didn't know you write erotic poetry." And I was like, "What erotic poetry have I put out publicly?" And he was like, "Your pomegranate poem." I was like, "That's about my grandpa." I use the word jiddo, which is Arabic for grandpa, in the poem. So I understand why he didn't get it. No, considering he doesn't speak Arabic. But yeah, I think that for me, similar to Sonia, there's a, for me, a pull to document and archive these people in my life and these conversations that I have with the people I cherish the most, especially when it comes to family. There's a lot that I can't tell them to their face and I can't share with them in person. So I found that writing it out kind of helps, and sharing it with this very special group has been quite the healing process.
Mariko, would you like to jump in there and tell us about yours?
Yes, so there's definitely some themes in my writing of time and just the passing of the seasons and how fleeting or temporary experiences and moments can be. So I find that there is often this element of the seasons changing and passing in my writing, or collecting moments from different parts of life and sharing bits of my story through this writing.
Thank you. We do have a question in the Q&A box. What makes an excellent poet?
I can speak to the process that we go through every Sunday, and we as Circle come together and we read great poetry and then we talk about it. So we have a chance to hear perspectives about what we read, and then we take inspiration from that and mix in things from our own life, from our ancestors and the things we're trying to process, and come out with the poems that we do. So it's being inspired by great poets, reading widely, discussing it, and then bringing our own experience into a new work of poetry.
Thank you.
I would add also, people who write poems make great poets. I teach creative writing at the Arts Academy in the Woods in Fraser, which pulls kids from all, you know, the whole Detroit area. And I was trying to get kids to register for my class for next year. And one student said to me, I just sometimes write poems like when I'm alone in my room. I was like, yeah, that's not something like everyone does. Like, if you write poems alone in your room, you're a poet. Hate to break it to you.
I have to agree, because I cannot write poetry at all. Tasha, the themes in yours, one, did I pick up on assimilation?
Oh, yes, definitely. And I have to piggyback off what Lujane said. It's been a very therapeutic process where you can definitely discuss things you may not typically discuss. And definitely that first poem, They Just Show Up, is definitely about assimilation, the grooming of trying to get into the dominant culture, and, you know, what that those compromises, you know, may cost. So, you know, that was a way for me to iron those things out and those thoughts, you know, out on paper and with this wonderful group. Definitely very therapeutic. So, yep, you're right on the money with that one.
Miss Adrian, what about you? What's the inspiration behind your work?
Good question. I really, ever since I was very young, I think that I made the way that I could make sense of the things around me was through writing poems. So I rarely have like an end point or a meaning when I start a poem. They're meanings that end up coming out of what I'm writing, if that makes any sense. Yeah, a lot of processing.
I have another question, and you all just feel free to jump in there with an answer. Why are you a poet?
I was born one.
I think it's one of the best ways to express yourself. Everything you want to express, but you could definitely still do it in a very like esoteric or cryptic way and be creative. And you can also, you know, almost like a mystery when you're looking through the words and the pages, trying to put it all together. So, thank you.
Lu Jian agrees 100%.
Yeah, I like the brevity of poetry. It doesn't always have to be brief, but what's not said is just as loud, and I appreciate that.
Yeah, exactly. I agree too, Lu Jian. Mm-hmm.
I just keep showing up and writing poems, and I hope that they become better and that they speak more and more over time as I keep showing up to this practice.
So you guys meet weekly. How long are the sessions?
We meet for 2 hours every Sunday. It's roughly split into four parts, not really timed or anything, but the first, I typically will pick either a poet or a theme that has a couple of different poems. So we'll usually look at about two, sometimes three poems. We'll read those often ahead of time so that we can come to the group with them already in our minds, and we discuss the poems for roughly a half an hour, and then we read them and discuss them for about a half an hour, and then we do a free write. That's one of, when I started this group, that was really, one was to create a community, and the other thing that was very important to me was to have time to write, instead of it just being a workshop where you're bringing in work and getting feedback and there's not actual time to sit down and write while you're there, because it's something that you know, a lot of writers will say they can't find the time to carve out to sit down and write. So this is just, there is always a half an hour or 40 minutes when after we've read some poems and I've given some prompts, usually based off of the poems or the poet. And then we have these prompts to, you don't have to use the prompts. You can write about anything at all, you know, whatever, but there's prompts to get us going, starting to write. And then we come back. It's a little break, you know, cameras go off, you go off by yourself for a half hour and then come back for the last half hour is usually sharing the writing that we've done during the free write time, and giving some feedback on that. And yeah, so that's basically what we do every week, every Sunday.
The library encourages writing also. We offer programs where you can, there's a creative writing one, and it's like every other week. One is creative writing, the other one is journaling. So it's pretty cool to hear you describe the process, because I often attend those workshops too. And she gives us prompts, and it depends on the workshop. If it's journaling, then you have less time. For the creative writing, it's 25 minutes to write about something. So that's pretty cool. I think it's great that the library and your group have come together for such a wonderful program. I failed to mention in the introduction that this is National Poetry Month, and I've always wanted to do something like this. So I'd like to thank Sonia for reaching out and giving me the opportunity to actually host a poetry program. Your work was amazing. Thank you so much. And if we don't have any more questions, we can bring this program to an end. I'd like to remind everyone that the program is recorded. And do I see someone who do have a question? And Ms. Taylor, is it something that I'm missing?
Well, I wanted to say, before we go, I wanted to say thank you to the library for reaching back out to me when I approached you about this program. I was I attended Genevieve's Thursday journaling workshops and the creative writing workshops. So I thought to get in touch with her about our group, and she was very receptive, and I appreciate that. Thank you, Tanika. Thank you, Ms. Taylor. And thank you to Genevieve and the Detroit Public Library. And thank you to Circle for your wonderful poetry.
Thank you. I really enjoyed it. Hope to do something like this again, ladies. So don't forget about us.
Yeah. We're working on Circle too, Cypher too.
Okay. So. Okay. Well, we'll bring this program to a close. And thank you, Circle, for joining us. I'd like to thank the participants for spending their evening with us. And thank you to my colleague for assisting with our technical things. And you all have a good night.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having us. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Take care.
Good night.